Brother Harry, he loved the songs of the church, so it would bless his family, and I know it will bless the heart of God. If we would all lift our voices and sing, when we all get to heaven, what a day of rejoicing it will be. When we all, come on church, see Jesus, we'll sing and shout the victory.
Yeah. Jesus said to his disciples, "Let not your hearts be troubled. If you believe in God, believe also in me. In my Father's house are many mansions. If it were not so, I would not have told you. But I go to prepare a place for you. And if I go to prepare a place for you, I will come again to receive you unto myself, that where I am, there you may be also." It's a great thing to know that we are not stuck in this life here. As good as it may be, as wonderful as Brother Harry was, I know that he rests with the Lord, and he's in a place that is so glorious and so wonderful that we all can just shout on his behalf, "Thank you, Lord, that there is another place. Thank you, God, that he has gone from earth to reward." We can still rejoice, for Job said, "The Lord gives and the Lord takes away." But the people of God still know what? Blessed is the name of the Lord. So why don't you right now just give the Lord a blessing. Give the Lord praise for the life and the legacy, the wonderful life of Harry Bernard Rogers, but for knowing that life here is just preparing us for life over there. And I'm so glad that he was well prepared for that. I greet you in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. And I know the family of Brother Harry Rogers is so grateful that you are here to walk with them and sit with them, to mourn with them, but to celebrate with them. What a wonderful man, what a wonderful life, what a wonderful family. We thank God for his wife, Sister Clissy. We thank God for his three sons, his daughters-in-law, his grandchildren, great-grandchildren, this great host of people who are in this place today. If you were blessed by the life of Brother Harry Rogers in one way or the other, why don't you just say amen? Amen. Amen. God is good. God is good all the time, and we are so grateful. I invite you to walk with us as the family has prepared a service of celebration. Right now, Minister Kenneth Robinson, who has walked with him for a good while through his times of ups and downs, is going to come and share words of comfort. Amen. 56 years. Yes, indeed. We will not forget that. Amen. That's longer than some folks are alive in here. Amen. That's worthy of celebration. Through the highs and the lows, through the ups and the downs, you were right there, Sister Clissy Ford Rogers, and we give God thanks for you. Amen. Come on now, let's just thank God for Sister Clissy. Let's thank God for her life. Amen. They say behind a good man is a good woman, but I tell you what, in many ways she made the man, and we thank God for that and for the sons that have come through their loins. Yes, he could. And we will not forget that. That's all right. You shout it out. You shout it out. You walk with him long enough. Anybody in here has some barbecue ribs from Harry Rogers? Come on now. Amen. Minister Robinson is going to come and share words of comfort. I'll come back and pray, and we'll follow the program as written.
To the family, I bring greetings from the Robinson family. I walked with Harry for a long time, and I'm grateful for his presence in my life. I just wrote down a few of the words to express to the family just how much we loved him. Brother Harry Rogers was a man I looked up to as a teenager growing up at Robert Street Church of God back in the late 50s and early 60s when Jim Sheely, Norman Sheely, the Curry Boys, the McCalls, the Somervilles, the Wilsons, the Averys, the rest of the young bucks that went to Robert Street Church of God, we're all growing up together. Later on, Brother Harry started working for the airlines as a skycap, handling luggage and getting people to their gates on time for their flights. Saw him many times, even taking Pastor Fowler up to the airport, and he would be there. I liked him as a skycap because he was always helpful making sure folks caught their flights on time. I also liked the Corvette he drove to church every Sunday when it was nice out, and singing bass with him in the men's chorus and the chancel choirs for more years than I can number. He was a man who loved his wife and family. His sons have grown to be men that their mom and dad are very proud of. We are too. Most of all, he loved his wife and cherished her for all their married life, and their sons were the apple of their eye, and who in their eyes could do no wrong. I love the way their sons and daughters-in-law and grandchildren rallied around mom and dad when they needed them most. May God's favor engulf each one of you, Scott, Jeff, Marty, and your families. May the peace of God ease your burdens and undergird you as you go through this time of sorrow. This is our prayer. Myself and my wife, Barbara Robinson. God bless you.
Let's pray together. It was through your servant David that we heard these words. The lines have fallen to me in pleasant places. Behold, I have a goodly heritage. Thank you, O God, for your wisdom in setting the lonely in families, the words of David as well. For it is in times like these that we recognize that our family heritage can mean so much. The foundation upon which Brother Harry's life was laid, his parents who loved you, who raised him in the church, enabled him to catch faith and bring that faith into his heart, into his life, by making a personal commitment of his life to you. And Lord, that is the greatest heritage that any of us can have. And I am so thankful to you that we call upon you on behalf of your son and his family. Thank you, Lord, that you are a God of all comfort and a God of all strength. And I pray for your comfort even in this moment. While we will celebrate, because there's so much to celebrate about Brother Harry, we also mourn, because you do not have someone who has meant so much in your life, married for 56 years, sons who have grown up to be men, but raised up as men right under his mentoring. Daughters-in-law and grandchildren who loved him and were doted upon by him. How we will miss him. Church members who were friends, not just members, but friends. Thank you, O God, for what he meant to us. But I thank you, O Father, that you are able to mean so much more. Lead us, guide us. Strengthen our hearts. Be with Sister Clissy, O Father, I pray. Mend brokenness in the mighty name of Jesus. Uplift her. Strengthen her. Encourage her. Give her insight into the hand of God that is moving in her life. Thank you for their sons who have rallied around them in their time of need. And I pray for them and their families. And I ask you, O God, that you would be a strong tower as you have promised to be. The name of the Lord is indeed a strong tower, and the righteous run to it, and we find safety. May they know above all that you are indeed their refuge and their strength, a very present help in time of trouble. Guide us even in this service today. that words will be spoken that will encourage and uplift our hearts, that we will hear a word from you that will set our path straight and keep our eyes upon you. For no matter what happens in this life, it is incumbent upon all of us to get ourselves ready to hear the same call that Brother Harry heard just a few days ago. Come home. It is time for you to give an accounting of your life. May we all be ready to hear your voice, not run and ask the mountains to fall upon us, because that will be entirely too late. But even now in this moment, may we all make our calling and election sure. Teach us to number our days, that we might apply our hearts to wisdom. May the glory and the honor be thine, because we know you will speak in this place. For more than two or three are gathered together in your name. And you promise when that occurs, you are in the midst of us. And so, God, be that just for us, we pray, in the mighty name of Jesus. And all the glory and the honor and the praise is thine alone. In Jesus' name we do pray. Amen. Amen. The word of the Lord is coming to us from the Old Testament and the New Testament. Alexandra Rogers, Kristen and Cameron Rogers, granddaughters, will read those texts. The choir is going to come back with a selection. And as you see your names on the program, let's just follow it, because the family has done a marvelous job of helping us to bring a time of celebration to this moment. Remarks are going to come from sons and video tribute, and following the video, our eulogy will come from his friend, his brother, his longtime pastor, the Reverend Dr. Ronald J. Fowler. Let's follow in that order, and may the Lord bless you as we do.
This is Isaiah 41:10. Fear not, for I am with you. Be not dismayed, for I am your God. I will strengthen you. Yes, I will help you. I will uphold you with my righteous right hand.
This is 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verses 1 through 5. For we know that if the earthly tent, which is our house, is torn down, we have a building from God, a house not made with hands, eternal in the heavens. For indeed in this house we groan, longing to be clothed with our dwelling from heaven. Inasmuch as we have put it on, will not be found naked.
For we who are in this tent groan, being burdened, not because we want to be unclothed, but further clothed, that mortality may be swallowed up by life. Now he who has prepared us for this very thing is God, who also has given us the Spirit as a guarantee.
Whoever wishes to be great among us must first become a servant. True greatness is not measured in what matters to man. It is measured and achieved only by doing what matters to God, and that is putting the needs of your neighbor before your own and being a servant. On October 30th, 2019, God's faithful servant, Harry Bernard Rogers, was rewarded eternal rest as he went home to be with his Savior, Jesus Christ. Born in Akron, Ohio, on January 17, 1936, to Samuel and Emma Rogers, Harry was the youngest of five siblings. He was a graduate of East High School in Akron and went on to work for United Airlines for over 50 years. Harry loved to travel, and working for United afforded him the ability for him and his family to see many places throughout the years. These special family vacations were a major contributor to building the closeness that his sons enjoy to this day. Although Harry touched the lives of so many, his greatest accomplishment was his family. Harry married his sweetheart, Clissy Mae Ford, on June 30, 1963. Their union brought about three sons, Scott, Jeffrey, and Martin Rogers. While having a family is not unique, having one that remains as close as the one he reared is not quite as common. Harry and Clissy remained inseparable until the very moment he passed away, and through his death, his sons have become even closer, which he would have loved.
Harry came to know the Lord on Thanksgiving Day in 1989. Surrounded by his family, Harry explained how the Lord had been tugging at his heart and that when he accepted Christ, he wanted to do it in the presence of those who were the greatest example for him. His wife had been a Christian for many years, and his three sons all had new, growing relationships with the Lord. So right there at the Thanksgiving dinner table, Harry prayed to receive Christ as his Savior and never look back. Harry's favorite place on this earth was Arlington Church of God, where he served faithfully under Reverend Dr. Ronald J. Fowler and current pastor, Reverend Dr. Diana L. Swoop. Oh, how he loved the music at Arlington. He loved to tap his feet, clap his hands, and lift his voice to the songs of old and new. He spent many years singing in the choir and hardly ever missed a concert given by the choir or various artists in the church. When attending church in his later years became difficult, he learned how to stream the services on his iPad and hardly ever missed a Sunday. Arlington Church of God remained a vital connection to his home in Akron until the day he passed away.
One of Harry's greatest passions was cooking. He established culinary greatness in Akron and beyond, and was a legend when it came to his barbecued ribs. With a rib recipe that he spent years developing, Harry was without question in a league of his own. Feeding people was one of his greatest joys, and it was how he showed love to so many on various occasions. Harry loved people the way Christ loved us. When people did not deserve love, he loved them anyway. When people did not deserve to receive, he gave generously. When forgiveness seemed unthinkable, not only did he forgive, but he seemingly forgot. And when a person had used up all of their chances with others, they would still have a chance with him. Harry was not a Bible scholar, but the life of Christ was evident in him by how he treated others. To the fatherless, he was a father. To the friendless, he was a friend. And to those found undesirable by others, they were always warmly welcomed into his presence. If you knew Harry, you knew what it was like to be loved. We will always remember his warm smile, his hearty laugh, his kind heart, and how he made all of our lives better. Rest in eternal peace, Harry Rogers. Well done. Well done.
Wow. Jeff, Martin. There they are. All I could think of while they were reading their, my dad's obituary was how beautiful our wives look. Their beauty is stunning. Growing up in my dad's house, he always put pressure on his sons, and he said, never to bring home any ugly girls. So I'd have to say, we honored his wish, don't you agree? Okay. On another note, I don't know if many of you know that there is a class action lawsuit against my father that will be settled today, right after coming back from the cemetery, for all the ones that have had their leg burned on his 69 Corvette. After we get back from the cemetery, complete payment will be made to where you'll be entitled to one fried chicken dinner and one glass of red punch. Okay. All right, all seriousness now, okay. It was hard for me to choose what to talk about. I was thinking maybe I should tell you about the time that I totaled my dad's 69 Corvette when I was 16. Or should I tell you about the time when I burned the second floor of their house down when I was 7? But instead, what I would like to do is I would like to share with you me and my dad's last conversation. The last time I spoke with my dad was over the phone on Sunday, October 27th, around 8:22 p.m. I just sat down with Monica to relax. I was exhausted, from our Halloween party that we had on Saturday at our home. I was so tired. I sat down, my phone rang, and guess who it was? It was my dad. He called to talk to me to see how I was doing and how the party turned out. He said, hey, how you doing? I said, Dad, I'm exhausted from this Halloween party. His questions were, what did you fix? I said, Dad, I made ribs. Monica made some chili, and then we ordered some pizza. Of course, you know his next question, how many slabs did you make? I said, I made 8 slabs, Dad. Now, you know that if you ever visited my parents' house, there was always one food item on hand that you can count on being there, and it was barbecue ribs. And for my birthday, I love licorice, along with a big package of red licorice and a nice birthday gift. It always came with a bottle of his sauce and a couple of slabs of ribs. To continue our conversation, he said, how many people showed up? I said, around 40, Dad. Next, he said, what did Raina dress up as? I said, she dressed up as a sunflower. And he said, well, what did you dress up as? I said, Dad, I dress up as a slave. And he laughed hysterically. I think, I made my dad laugh a lot, I believe. And I did feel like a slave waiting on all those people. So for 20 minutes, we continued to talk about the party and how he was doing, and then our conversation started to wind down a little. I was exhausted from the day before. I told my dad I was tired, and I asked him if we could finish talking another time, because I was just really beat. And he said, okay. And we said goodbye. I feel like our conversation wasn't complete. One day, we will finish our conversation, and we will have many more. Quickly, I would like to share with you a precious time that I had with my dad, and I call it a pleasant time with my dad. We lived in Hudson, Ohio for 15 years and decided to sell our home to move closer to Monica's school. We sold our home really fast and didn't have a new house to move into. My wife was so sick of the drive from Hudson to Cleveland, going to work every day, that after we sold our home, you know, even though we didn't have a house, we rented her an apartment at the Alcazar in Cleveland Heights. No pets were allowed at the Alcazar. At the time, we had one cat and one dog. And to try to save money from boarding costs, I knew of a great place that was free and didn't mind pets, had free food, Wi-Fi, cable TV, and free advice, even if I didn't ask for it. It was at my mom and dad's house. Monica and Shayna stayed at the apartment while me and the pets stayed at my mom and dad's house. We were there for 4 months. This whole thing was about 5 years ago. I set up my entire office in their living room. I was living in my parents' home again, but as a man, not a child. It was during the fall. My dad and I sat outside in the backyard and we talked, mostly of nothing, but we talked. It was the beginning of football and basketball season. We watched it together and we ate together. Every Friday night, Aunt Mildred would bring over fried perch for my parents, and guess who got to have some too? We finally found a home in Moreland Hills. It was time to go and pack up and leave my parents' house. What a wonderful time I had with both of my parents. Do you remember that, Mom? Especially my dad. As I was packing to leave, I cried so hard. I cried so hard. Nobody witnessed it, though, you know? A few weeks later, I learned my dad did the same. He cried as well. Throughout my life, I've seen many relatives and friends die and have gone to many funerals. You know, my dad, he escaped death a lot within the last few years to the point where I thought he had 9 lives. I never wanted him to leave us. It was on my lunch break that I got a scary text from Jeff. It said, "Call me now," with an exclamation point at the end. I said to myself, "Oh Lord, what has gone wrong now?" But this time, God called him home. "I love you, Dad. I miss you. I'm glad you are not suffering and are with the Lord. I will see you again."
So those of you that knew my dad, Harry Rogers, well, you knew that he liked to have a good time. No matter where he was at, he liked to have a good time. So in honor of him, during my remarks, we're going to have a good time. Now, you probably notice I don't have a suit jacket on. My dad knew that I didn't like to wear a suit jacket and tie. So I'm up here comfortable now. But this was very hard to prepare remarks for my dad's funeral. I remember speaking with someone yesterday, and I told them, before your parents pass away, go ahead and prepare remarks right now, because I wanted to spend some more time on these remarks, but the funeral's today, I'm out of time. I gotta get up here with what I got. So this is what I got. As far as me, don't really worry about me losing my dad. I worry about my mom more than I worry about me. She lost her husband of 56 years. It was so much fun growing up as a kid in Harry and Clissy Rogers' house. So much fun. When I was in my dad's presence, it was like it was magic in the air. I loved him dearly, and he loved me dearly. 2 months ago on Labor Day weekend, I got to go up to Atlanta and tell my mom and dad, "Thank you for everything, Mom and Dad," because I didn't know how long I was going to have either one of them. So I ran through some things and told my dad, "Thank you for them," and his reply to me was, I wish I could have done more. Shortly after April and I got married in 1992, we lived with my parents for 2.5 years. Anybody remember that? A lot of people would have said, I raised this kid 18 years, and he's not coming back. He's got to make it on his own. But without hesitation, April and I hit some struggles. My dad said, come on back. My mom and dad said, come on back. And we were there for 2.5 years. And another time that my dad helped me out was in 2015. April and I bought a house in Winter Garden, Florida. We had to put down 10% on this house. It was a lot of money. So if you want to see how much my house costs, you could probably Google me. Or you could probably go to realtor.com, but I'm not going to tell you. But 10% was a lot. It was all we had. And then the bank needed us to show another $5,000, which we didn't have. I got on the phone, called up Dad without hesitation. He said, you got it. Let me know what I need to do. He helped me out in my life where a lot of parents would not help out. But I think I turned out okay. Dad was a big football fan. And, you know, when you come to your parents' funeral, you think of what are you going to wear. I had no idea which tie I was going to wear until I left home yesterday. In honor of my dad, this is a Pro Football Hall of Fame tie. And one of the greatest gifts that I gave my dad is somebody who watched football solid. Saturday, the game started at noon. There's a game at noon, there's a game at 4, there's a game at 8. He watched all of them. Sunday, the game start at 1 o'clock. He watched the 1 o'clock, 4 o'clock, and then NBC has Sunday night football. So he watched a lot of football. And one of the greatest gifts I gave him as his son was winning 2 back-to-back state championships in football at Buchtel High School in 87 and 88. I did get to see Ricky Powers earlier. He was here, and Tobin Buckner. I can't see. I don't have my glasses on. You hear, Toby? Yeah, we did it. And then I also went on to Kent State to play 2 years for them, and I was their leading scorer in 1990. So my dad lives on in all three of us. And I'd like to share with you some ways he lives on in all of us. Much to my surprise, a lot of men, and I found this out recently, a lot of men either don't cook, won't cook, or can't cook. But all three of us, we can cook. And it's a blessing to have a father and a husband in your house that can cook. Can I get an amen? So all of us cook because of the example that my dad set for us. Now, when it comes to cooking ability, my brother Scott and I don't think we can cook. We can hold our own in the kitchen. But the dishes that we prepare probably don't have any more than 5 ingredients in them. I tell you, if it has more than 5 things in it, I'm not cooking it. But my dad, he had a seasoning that he used to make that you sprinkle on food. It had a bunch of stuff, and I don't even know what it had in it. My dad made his own sauce with probably like 25, 30 ingredients in it. That's too overwhelming for me. But one of his sons went in the kitchen with him one day and wrote down all the ingredients that he put in his sauce, and maybe one day he'll make you a bottle of it. But out of that example that my dad made for us, my brother Jeff has taken that and he's blown it up huge. He's a culinary fanatic. He has tens of thousands of followers on Instagram and also YouTube. He has millions of views on YouTube. And my belief is it started with a spark from watching my dad in the kitchen cooking. Now, my dad lives on in Scott. Scott is a very generous guy. I believe in the verse that comes from the book of Hesitations. God helps. And that verse is God only helps those who help themselves. But Scott will tell me somebody was in his presence, and he will tell me what he did for him. And there's no way I would have done for them what he did for them. Like give him some money or buy him a suit, buy him some clothes, just be very generous with him. And Scott's generosity has touched my life also. So also with my dad, I'm a salesman. I've been a pharmaceutical salesman for 21 years. People don't like salesmen. A lot of you, when you see a salesman, you run. You go the other way, or you hang up the phone. But I got from my dad exceptional relationship building skills that has helped me on my job. And also got from my mom her determination. So out of my dad's relationship building skills and my mom's determination, I've had a great career in pharmaceutical sales, which I'll just tell you about the last 3 years. I made President's Club, which is top 10% performer at your company, in 2016 and 2017. And my performance review for the last 3 years has been exceeds expectations. Thank you, Mom and Dad. Thank you to Jeff and Scott and Monica and Falana for carrying a lot of the load with Mom and Dad and all of their illnesses and trips to the hospital. Looking at us, you would think that the care for my mom and dad should be split 33%, 33%, 34%. It's got to equal 100%. But really, it has been 45, 45, and 10. I have two disabled children, and my brothers understand that I can't carry as much of the load as they've been able to carry. And they've never made me feel bad for that. So, and also, Mom has had 3 boys, never had a girl. She was hoping I would be a girl because I'm the baby. And my name would have been Carla after my Uncle Carl. But Mom, you are 80 years old. You finally got that daughter at age 79, Falana. Thank you, Falana, for caring for my mom like a daughter. When I first spent time with my mom after my dad passed away, I went into the nursing home, and I was there to bring her comfort. And my mom said to me, it was almost lunchtime, she said, I want a hot dog. And I said to myself, oh, no. Is she able to even eat a hot dog with her diet? I mean, I don't know. I mean, I don't know her like Falana knows her. I picked up the phone and called Falana, and she gave me instruction on what to do. And we went and got that hot dog and had it, didn't we, Mom? So we talked about my dad being generous, giving you all, giving people ribs, banana pudding. I've seen my dad through the years take a $20 bill, $50 bill, $100 bill, hand it to someone. If my dad has touched your life by giving you some food or some money, would you do me a favor and stand? And if you can't stand, if you could just wave. If he's touched your life by giving you some food or something to eat or some money. Thank you. So in 2004, I'm almost done, everybody. In 2004, I moved away from Akron, Ohio to Florida. That was a tough decision. It's too cold here. When we arrived to the airport and stepped outside, that cold hit us. Hit us, me and my family, Floridians. And when I got in the car, after loading everything, my hands started to hurt just from the cold. My dad never spoke against me moving to Florida. He supported it as much as he was sad to lose me. But that provided my mom or dad 2 to 3 weeks every year to come down and be outside and enjoy the warmth in the wintertime here. Two more things, and I'm done. Yes. My dad was a legend at the airport. When I would go to the airport to take a flight for business, all the skycaps knew him. My dad worked for United, but all the skycaps knew him. The skycaps from Delta knew him, American Airlines, Continental. When they would talk to me about my dad, it was like they were talking about a superstar like LeBron James or Tiger Woods. The look in their eyes talking to me about my dad and like how cool he was or what he did for him. And I would be thinking to myself, man, you better be quiet. You're going to make me late for my plane talking about my dad. Let me go catch my plane. So in all seriousness, I'd like to end with, my dad was not in the best of health. I'm thankful to have had him for 83 years. One thing that my dad said that was kind of a joke when you look at like medical things, maybe like blood pressure or maybe blood sugar level. Blood sugar level in the morning, fasting blood sugar should be around 100. If his is at 180 or 200, the way he would dismiss it, oh, blacks are different. those numbers they have for blood sugar readings, blood pressure should be 120 over 80. If his is like 160 over 100, forget that 120 over 80. It's different for blacks. So what I'm saying to do today, if you need to do better with your health, maybe use today this sad occasion as a turning point in your life. I'd love for some of you to call me 6 months from now and say, you know, when Brother Harry passed away, I decided to start working out. Or when Brother Harry passed away, I decided to stop consuming so many carbs and sugar. My blood sugar readings are good now, and I've maybe lost 10 or 20 pounds. So use today as a turning point in your life for your health. I love my dad. He was my hero. And I knew today was coming. And much like Scott, I had said my dad was like a cat. He had 9 lives. But this time God said, come on home. Well done, good and faithful servant.
Well, thank you everybody for being here. My dad would have been pleased with this. When we started talking about planning his funeral, we were all in agreement with, we didn't want a sad funeral because that's not what dad would have wanted. You know, like they both said, my dad liked to have a good time and he would have loved the music and he would have loved to see all of you out here. People have traveled and we are appreciative. We're appreciative. Most of what I had to say, I put into the obituary, so I'm just going to be really brief. My fondest memory of being a kid was going places with my dad. You know, with 3 boys in the house, one-on-one time came at a premium. And so whenever I got a chance to be with my dad by myself, I always jumped at it. So Fridays, I would go to the grocery store with him. He used to take me to the Lantern on the corner of Copley and the expressway there. And he let me have coffee, and I was probably 5 or something. So that's probably why I'm the shortest. But you know, or if he was out on the grill cooking ribs, I was always right there with him. I never missed it. And so, you know, I lived to please my dad, and we all did. He was very particular about how he wanted things. And I always did my best to exceed his expectations, whether it was if I had to clean the bathroom, I would always make sure I'd polish the faucets and they would shine. And if I'm cutting the grass, the lines would be perfectly straight. And, you know, I think a lot of those expectations that he had, he passed on a healthy portion to me. And I'm grateful for that. My brothers and I have had a multitude of intimate moments with my dad. But I hold the moments I hold dear are the moments that I had with him alone. When I learned that my dad passed, we rushed to the nursing home where he and my mom live currently, and I went in, and he was in the room alone. My mom wasn't in the room, and I asked Valana, I said, you know what, I just want to go in by myself. And so I went in, and there he was. He looked like he was sleeping, very peaceful, you know, just looked like he always does. And I went in and, stroked his body. I held his hand, and I kissed him, and I told him that I loved him. And in his death, that was the most intimate moment I had with my father. And that's how God works. He takes a tragic moment and he makes it beautiful. Only God can do that. Only God can do that. Now, you heard the story in the obituary of my father receiving Christ. And my dad, man, my dad was a great man before he received Christ. But God put my father in the position to receive a great reward in heaven. And, you know, if you're sitting here today and you don't know Christ, my dad knew Christ, and that is what he would want for you. So do not let my dad die in vain. If you do not know the Lord, you need to give that some serious thought. That changed my father's life. You know, one of the things that a lot of you guys don't know, when my mom and dad got married, my dad wasn't saved. And I think there was a lot of people that encouraged my mom, do not marry him because he is not saved. And, you know, my mom prayed for him for years and years and years. And every once in a while, that being unequally yoked would raise its nasty head. But I never forget on that Thanksgiving day when, we almost fell on our chairs when he sat there and got saved. And he was a different man. He, you know, one thing I know about him, after he got saved, he cried a lot more. You know, I mean, my dad, he'd be watching a Hallmark commercial and he'd just be in tears. He cried at everything. And so, like I was saying, he looked peaceful, and I told him that I loved him. And this here today, this is for everybody else. I got to say goodbye last week, and man, it was beautiful. It was beautiful. I would just want to give a few special thanks, and there's no possible way that I could thank everybody that touched his life in a special way. But there are some people that I want to talk about. To Arlington Church of God, to Dr. Swoop, Dr. Fowler, the choir, and all of the members, thank you for making Arlington Church of God my father's favorite place in the world. Dr. Fowler, you know how my dad felt about you. And Pastor Swoop, my dad was your biggest fan. He really was. Kenny Robinson. Man, you know, the thing about when my mom and dad moved to Atlanta, we pretty much lived at the hospital all the time, whether it was him in the hospital or her in the hospital. One time they were in the hospital at the same time, and they put them in on the same floor. And so, but every time he would go in for something to have, you know, have something done, we were all like, you know, we were always like, man, I wish Kenny could be here. You know, because Kenny was always, every surgery my dad had in Akron, man, if my dad had surgery at 4 in the morning, Kenny was there at 3:30 in the morning praying for him. And so, I appreciate him. To my best friend of 51 years, Ronnie, I just want to say thank you to Ronnie because, although it's part of his job, Ronnie set up streaming here at this church. And when my parents in their later years got to where they couldn't come to the church, they streamed. My dad learned how to stream the services on his iPad, and they hardly ever missed a Sunday. And I'm telling you, when they were in Atlanta, them streaming was the highlight. You know, streaming these services was the highlight of their week, and so I am grateful for that. My mom still streams every Sunday. They would stream. So thank you so much to our family in Akron. Thank you for looking after my father, Regina, Rita, Mike, and Pat, who has gone home to be with the Lord. Susan and Marvin, Tony. And Pat, who has gone home to be with the Lord, and there's so many others I can't mention everybody. Thank you, thank you, thank you, Daryl and the Akron Fire Department. I think y'all just had us on speed dial because they were at our house multiple times. And thank you so much for taking care of them.
to Chris and Jenny Manier. They're my dad's next door neighbors, and I don't think that God could have placed a better family to live next door to my parents, from blowing his snow, to taking out his garbage, to fixing my mom's computer, when to always seeing on them and checking on them, calling us when we needed to be called in on something. We would have had this funeral a couple of years ago if it wasn't for Jenny, who went over to his house one day, and he was having a bout with low blood sugar, and we got the paramedics there, but if she hadn't been there, we would have had this funeral a couple of years ago. So thank you, guys. I love you. See you in the driveway later. They know what that means. So, to his close friends, Mike Bates. He's been his friend forever. Mike and his wife, Nancy, they were the best to me, Scott and Marty. And Mike, my dad, loved you dearly. He loved you dearly. Mike got to see him a few weeks ago when he came to Atlanta. And he loved you guys, Polly, Megan. All of you guys, he loved you guys. Natalie, thank you for your friendship with my father. To Reggie Garland, Reggie, my dad loved you like a son, and he really did. He loved you like a son, and Reggie came down to see my dad a few weeks ago, and it was great. It was great. So, Reggie, thank you for your friendship. To his friend, Steve Sonderman. Steve would come by oftentimes and take my dad to lunch, and he was just a good, just a good companion for my dad. And he always saw about my dad. And Steve, my dad loved you dearly. You know, we get a lot of credit for what we've done for my mom and dad in the last year, but and it's been hard. You know, it's been really hard being their caretakers. But to Scott and his wife Monica, they helped. They held it down for 30 years while me and Marty were elsewhere. And, you know, I would always get calls from Scott going over to mom and dad's, you know, mom did this or dad did this. And Scott held it down for 30 years. And so I just want to say thank you to the original first responder. You know, I think one of the greatest gifts that I've received in my life is to be able to have my mom and dad in my life for the last year. I was fortunate enough for my dad to be in my life for his last year of life. And my wife gave me that gift. When we went and got my mom and dad a year ago, you know, I told her what was going on. And I said, we need to go get my mom and dad. And she said, okay, no questions asked. And the three times that they've lived with us, that's always been the case. And so she has been amazing with my parents, from the way that she organizes their medical information and pays their bills and handles all their, you know, their finances and all. And she would attend all of my father's appointments with him, whether it be cancer appointment or what have you. And she loved him like he was her own father. And I just want to say thank you. I love you. And I married the right woman. I married the right woman. And to Kristen, Cameron, and Patrick. Patrick's over there. You guys are my crew. And, I think of all the times that we, you know, rushing either Granny or Grandpa to the hospital. You guys are always there spending time with them in the hospital, going to see them at their facility. The late nights that we had with them. Thank you, guys. I love you guys dearly. We have no regrets. You know, we have no regrets. My father walked this earth for 83 years. 83 years. He was my father for 51 years. I know I don't look 51, but he walked this earth for 83 years. And, we took trips together, him and the boys, to Las Vegas a couple times. We took a cruise one time. And, man, we had a great life with my dad. We had a great life with my dad. And so as I stand here before him today, you know, I know this is his shell, but I fully, fully understand what it means by the verse where it says that death has no sting, you know. And if you are a believer in Christ, death has no sting. Yes, we miss him, and, you know, I will miss him forever. But, man, I got to tell you, in a strange way, this is one of the happiest days of my life, you know. My dad is home with Christ. He is no longer suffering. There's no more chemo. There's no more dialysis. There's no more doctor's appointments. You know, so my dad is happy, and I'm happy for him, and I'm grateful that God chose him to be my dad. Thank you.
I'd like to take this opportunity to read this church resolution in memory of Mr. Harry Rogers from Zion Faith Fellowship. Life is but a vapor that appeareth for a little while, and soon it vanisheth away. But we know that as Christians, though our life on earth may cease, we have a home eternal in heaven with God Almighty. This resolution is extended with love and sympathy to his family, Mrs. Rogers, my friends, Scott and Monica, Jeff and Philana, Marty and April, and their families on the passing of Mr. Harry Rogers. While in elementary school, my parents normally didn't let me go to other people's homes unless it was family, church members, or people they could trust. One of these families was the Rogers family, who lived a few streets up from us. Having no brothers, it was interesting to see their dynamic. They'd crack on each other, wrestle, fight, but help each other. For me, it was always fun being there. Mr. Rogers was one of the coolest men I knew. Back in the 70s, he had that processed hair and a fantastic Corvette. It was the first I'd ever seen. Every time I'd see one of any color, it always reminds me of him. To Mrs. Rogers, my brother Scott, Jeff, and Marty, and your families, please know you have my prayers and support. On behalf of my wife, Lady V. Lynette Parker, and my family at Zion, we express our most heartfelt sympathy to the family, and we furthermore encourage the family to continue to trust in our Lord Jesus Christ because we believe that we shall see him again. Be it resolved, this resolution is lovingly submitted to the family, and a copy shall be placed in our church records. Humbly submitted on this 9th November 2019, Suffragan Bishop David Parker II, Pastor, Zion Faith Fellowship, Regional Bishop, Northeast Region, Ohio District Council of Pentecostal Churches. Thank you.
Yeah. It hurts when I smile, 'cause my heart still remembers when you were around, 'cause you were there when no one was, just when I thought nobody cared. Showed me love, 'cause you were my friend. You always showed me yes, and now you're still here, because you were there. Where kids could still begin.
I have had an incredible life. Mainly, I owe the credit to the circle of friends that I was privileged to share childhood and youth with. We're all a combination of what other people add to us. And in looking at this audience this morning, I thought, how like my friend, my brother. At a time when our community and our world was increasingly becoming less interested in building bridges, Harry, from the very beginning, was a bridge builder. He reached beyond the circle of his own family and formed relationships with people whom he came to admire greatly. White people, black people, did not matter with him. In that, he learned the lessons that his parents were trying to teach him and how to be a person for all seasons. I owe God so much for the privilege of walking with him. I was his other brother. We had much in common. I reminded him occasionally that I was his senior, because we shared the same birthday, the 17th. I was born in December the 17th, 1935. He was born in January the 17th, 1936. I had him by 30 days. Our relationship developed over the years because we both were wise enough to marry above our pay grade. You cannot imagine how awestruck Harry was when a young man who had walked across town and walked into the church on Robert Street and gave his heart to the Lord, and he had a sister who was a tall, stately young lady, well-proportioned, beautiful appearance. She wore glasses. We thought she was a nerd, because she was so smart. He was awestruck. And I remember at a mixer nudging him in the side and said, "Man, go for it. Go for it." And he was wise enough to take that advice. They would have an incredible marriage and incredible children. Listening to the young men speak, I thought, nah, they got it wrong this time. They were the eulogist. No finer eulogy could be delivered than what they'd said from this platform. I'm so proud of them. I'm only going to take 10 minutes or less to say a few words that I think brings his life together. There is a text that I think has Harry's name all over it. It's in Psalm 37. If you ever get a chance to read this psalm, do so. Psalm 37. And the text says this in verse 23. "The steps of a good man are ordered by the Lord, and he delights in his ways." The steps, the decisions that propel a life to go forward, is referred to as steps. The ability to not only pursue the right goals, but to make the right decisions, to do those things that honor God, is what this text is all about. If I had to give a subject to the text, I would say it's God's prescription and our predicament. The text brings together those twin aspects of life. A human predicament. What is it? Making the right step. A misstep can be very costly in life, and so one is very serious about doing what they believe ought to be done. They move with intentionality, with purpose. Why? Because a misstep could bring ruin, tragedy, could lead one off course and cause one to experience undue pain. Your steps are so important because those that are taken in light of God's illumination, that which God reveals, gives us the assurance that we are moving in the right direction. And when we're moving with God, great things will happen. Great things will happen. What is this predicament all about? Take care of your steps. He did so well. Harry was not a person who was known to get up and make a speech, but he thought deeply about life. And he made decisions rather consistently that would enable not only his marriage to become stronger, thanks to his good wife, but enable his children to be proud. He was my best friend. Because his steps were honored by the Lord, I ended up being blessed by him. He was a man of compassion. He took that step. He cared deeply about others. Something was going on at the church there at Robert Street, and it required we young people to all wear a coat, we boys. And in those days, young boys weren't interested in wearing suit coats. But nevertheless, to be fitting with the occasion, I arrived at church and I was waiting for the brothers to come, that small core group that I associated with. And Harry came bouncing across the street because he lived just across the street from the church. And he looked at me and I said, man, I wish I had a tie. He had on the neatest tie you've ever seen. And I said, I didn't have a tie to wear. I didn't own a tie. And he said, Brother Ron, that's okay. Don't worry about that. He turned around and ran back to his house. He soon came, and in his hand were two ties. He said, which one of these do you think will work best? I said, I don't know. What do you think? And he chose one. And I said, I don't know how to tie a tie. He said, well, I'll tie it. And he put the tie on me and tied it. And I said, how does it look? He said, you look fine. I said, thank you. I said, where'd you get the tie? He said, oh, don't tell my brother Marvin. It's one of his ties. His brother Marvin was the sharpest dresser on the east side of Akron. I was proud to be wearing his tie, even though he didn't know it. But that was Harry. He was always concerned about others. You didn't have to be at his house on July the 4th to get a plate. He would prepare it and call you and say, come get it. That was Harry. You didn't have to make a big noise about the need in your life. If he knew it, he just did it. That was Harry. I love that guy. He went out for the football team and he made it. I was on the team. And Harry, I always wish he had the size I always wanted. And he reminded me that I had the passion that he wanted. They had him trapping. I never will forget it in practice. He trapped a guy and hit him and smashed him to smithereens. And then the next thing I saw, he's over there picking the guy up. I said, Harry, you don't pick him up. No. But he cared. He didn't want the fellow to be hurt. That was Harry. We were sitting on the church wall. Those of you who remember Robert Street, there was a wall in front of the church, and we guys used to sit there and wait for church to end so we could talk to the girls. And Bunny was there, Billy Curry, he was there. Silas brothers, I believe, were there as well. They were always there. I was there. I'm not sure if Richard was there or not, but just a fabulous group of young men. We were waiting for church to end, and a car pulled up. And the car pulled up because Bunny had left us and ran home, and coming down the street was this brand new Ford. It was a beautiful car. And Bunny was driving. William was his name. We called him Bunny. He was driving his car. And he said, would you guys like to go for a ride? We said, yes. And we jumped in the car, and off we went, singing the songs of the church, riding down and through town. We rode all over Akron, singing church songs. And the police pulled us over. And they asked the driver for his driver's license, and he didn't have it. And they found out whose car it was, and did you have permission from the owner to drive? He didn't have permission. They took us to jail in a police wagon. We're locked up in jail. So what do you do when you're locked up in jail? You sing church songs. We started so singing that even the guards who were there, they came and listened in. And Reverend Theodore Wilson came and bailed us out. And if you knew Reverend Wilson, he was not a happy camper. And we knew we were in for it. But we were together in jail singing church songs. If Harry were here, he'd be in the choir. It was his gift. It was his ministry. That guy meant a lot to me. He meant a lot to me. In fact, they all did. Bunny's gone to be with the Lord. Richard's gone to be with the Lord. So many of them that gave added meaning to my life. I even told Harry on one occasion, Harry, hey, you don't have to call me Reverend or Brother Ron. You know, Joe's okay. Joe's okay. He said, okay. And the next thing out of his mouth was, hey, Brother Ron, such and such. I said, you don't have to do. He could not call me by my first name, even though I gave him permission to do it. He had that kind of respect. Let me give you three things and take my seat. Three things to think about. Because the predicament about life is that you got to be careful where you step. And the older you become, the more conscious you become of what? Taking a step. When you reach my age, the nurse comes in to talk to you, and one of the first things she asks you, and they let you know you are a senior citizen, too. Have you fallen recently? And the answer is, no, I have not. I'm learning to take a good step. It's amazing when you start taking the right steps, how God comes along and assists you in moving in the direction that he wants your life to go. And it's no secret the blessings that came to Harry and Chrissy. They took the right steps. In fact, if I looked at this text, the prescription that God rolls out for people who want to make the most out of their lives. Do with the time that God gives them the things that enables their life to accomplish something that leaves a heritage for those who are coming behind. Makes their children proud of them. And what are those three simple fundamental things? And I think you find them in this man's life. If you look there in chapter 37, in fact, over in verse 3, right at the top of the list, trust in the Lord. Don't be ashamed of acknowledging Jesus Christ as Lord. He is a friend that sticketh closer than a brother. And when he sees his children moving in the right direction, it's amazing how God comes along and opens doors they could never open and give them favor they could never get by themselves and work things out in ways they never dreamed could be worked out. When we trust in God, the payoff is beyond imagining. It's beyond our wildest dreams because God is real and anyone he sees taking a step in the direction that honors him, he comes along and gives them strength to do what? Take another step. And before you know it, they're experiencing arrivals that enable their lives to be so immensely blessed of God. That was Harry. He was what he was because his steps were honored by the Lord. The step of faith, trust in the Lord with all your might. Lean not to your own understanding, and in all your ways, if you acknowledge him, he'll take you right to the top. He'll give you the best of everything. Also, if you were to look at that verse, look what follows it immediately. If you can throw it on the screen, put it on the screen. That verse there, verse 3, trust in the Lord and do good. What is it that God expects of us? Harry tells us, what is it, Harry, that God expects of us? I believe he would shout back at us, Brother Ron, do all the good you can for as many people as you can. And when you can no longer do it, pray that God will fill the void. Do good. You won't lose. Do good. You'll be repaid. Cast your bread out on the water. And after many days, it will return. Do good. That's the way he raised those boys, now young men. Do good. I shall never forget. I'm at West Middlesex, and I arrived late because our cabin was right across the street from Harry's cabin. And every year, for as long as I can remember, Harry always painted his rocks in front of his cabin, white lime, put white lime on them. And every year, the rocks in front of my cabin had white lime on it. He did that. My brother, my friend, did that. Do good. God won't forget you. He'll bless you. Trust in the Lord. Do good. What's that third thing that he mentions there? and commit thy way unto the Lord. Commit thy way unto the Lord. It hurt me at times to chat with him because I knew what he was going through, and I tried to hide it. I hope I did. But I often had to beat back the tears because I wanted to be there with him so badly. And I couldn't. And I had to commit it to God. God, take care of him. Watch over her. And the Lord did it. Life will break you if you never learn how to commit, how to give it to God, how to respond to his initiative, his invitation to trust him, to offer up to him the pain that you cannot remove and the situation you cannot resolve. We call it turning it over to him in prayer, knowing that he will always move at the appropriate time to do what needs to be done. That is God. I know he did it. I know he did it. Last but not least, he says in verse 4 of chapter 37, delight yourself. You know, if you're around Harry, you couldn't be around him and just suck on dill pickles. He was a happy guy. He had every right to be happy. He had the best of wives. You see them, all those pictures of them smooching on each other? 63 years married, was it? 50 something? Well, I should know just a year later after mine. And the pictures, they still smooching on each other. Not tired. Yeah. Delight yourself. God said, don't put restrictions on you. Enjoy the journey. Enjoy the journey. Because as I reminded a funeral service just the other day, look at the cross. Focus on it for just a second. Note how long that horizontal beam is. It's short. It's reminding us that life is fleeting. Life is brief. Life is like vapor put on a window, and soon it disappears. The shortness of that horizontal beam is telling us something. It's preaching a sermon. Take care. Make the right steps. You do not know when the last step will be. Do the things you can do while you can do them. Why? Because life has brevity to it. And if you keep looking at it, I must close with this. Look at the vertical beam. Look how long it is. That's eternity, friends. The cross beam, that's time. The long beam, that's eternity. Where you're going is so much longer than where you have been. And God said, get ready, make the right step, and make your step count. Do it for Jesus. And he'll give you back life. And who knows, he may have a Clissy May in your future for you. The best of all ladies that I know, along with my good wife. The absolute best. He'll bless you every time. Short. Eternity. You make the decision. Choose Christ. It won't be long. As I told him the other day, thanks for what you've done for me. I'll see you in the morning.
Our Father, we thank you. Thank you that you have met us here. And thank you that you are still ordering steps. We do pray that you will guide us even from this place as we move to the cemetery, and even those who may be moving back to their various places of residence. Order our steps, O God. And Father, we pray that you would honor us as we do, as we follow you. Thank you for your people. Thank you for this family. Lead us and guide us, Lord, I pray. In the awesome and mighty name of Jesus the Christ, we do pray. And the people of God together said, amen, amen. I invite you all to stand with us as the family and those on the pulpit recess at this time.